All right, so you started DCAP. You look at it from the AI and the digitization.
Data.
Yeah, so regarding this week, with the banking and everything that was happening, what were you seeing?
What ends up happening is, like, these, you've got thousands of companies that rely on SVB for banking, and these are the deposits, and this is everything that they sort of worked out this weekend. But, and, you know, for depositors, it's totally fine. But there are lots of companies, I would say, I don't know how many, but I'd say hundreds of companies that rely on them for lines of credit. And these are tech companies. These are tech companies that likely could manufacture, or like they have a critical component to someone else's software that's part of their tech stack, right? So like you look at our tech stack, there's 36 different technologies in it. If one of those technologies is in SVB and they require a line of credit, sure, the deposits are all taken care of, but like now they have to extend these lines of credit and they haven't figured that out yet. And if they go under or there's like something problematic with them, then a piece of my tech stack just broke. And so I may not be able to send and receive information. And so when you're talking about like an SEC compliant software, it's incredibly important that, especially with like regulations and compliance and all the different complexities that go into it, it's important that our software not break. Right. So this is why, like, for technologists or anybody who is in software, you have to have these redundancies. So like if you find out that a company goes under, make sure that you have another company that can come in and fill that void.
But you're right. There's a whole back end software issue, right?
Yeah.
You know, the bank tightened on lending, right? They might not want to extend the credit lines to some of those tech companies.
Then what happens to these companies? You know, either they go under or they get acquired by some bigger tech company.
Let's not forget, so Silicon Valley Bank, that was their business. Their mm-hmm. business was to invest through debt or equity or even venture capitalists into these new early startup software platforms, mm-hmm. a lot of them don't make any money. They're sitting on these big valuations, but there's no cash flow,
mm-hmm.
right? So you could squeeze them down pretty quickly and then take the tech. Is that what you're saying?
I mean, that's theoretically what could happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, when companies don't have the money to continue to function or work, somebody's got to take it over, especially, and if they've got billables, and I mean, you're talking about large companies, these companies could be doing well into the tens, $50 million, but they still require these lines of credit. And largely, Silicon Valley is massively overhired. I mean, we're talking 10, 20% of the workforce does 80% of the work. And so, and we're already seeing this from Facebook down, everybody else, they're starting to downsize it. It was just, they were massively overhired.
It started last year, you know, as they started laying off all these people. We were talking about that today. That's just their stock price, right? And they're trying to get the, whoever thought that maybe a company has to cash flow, right?
Yeah.
Well, those Twitter people, I mean, they were posting videos on how easy their job was all over YouTube. And then had channels dedicated to it. So then obviously they were cut when Elon took over and, you know.
And look at Twitter, it's still running.
Isn't that, that's a crazy number. What he cut like over half the workforce.
I think over 70%.
70%.
Yeah. I don't know that for sure, but it's.
Yeah.
I wanted to have you on because you talked about blockchain and real estate. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, a lot of our viewers, they listen and they are aware of crypto and the blockchain market there. But Ken and I recently have talked to some people about this tokenization of real estate. And I think it's really fascinating. So do you want to touch on that?
First thing I would say is blockchain and crypto are separate things. Like crypto operates on blockchain. Tokenization operates on blockchain. A lot of people have the notion that crypto and blockchain are the same, and they're not. And this is why you have people like Larry Fink, who is the CEO of BlackRock, coming out and saying that the tokenization of securities is the future of the securities market. One, you know, it's incredibly transparent, so you can see exactly who owns the asset. Right now, if you wanted to sell in secondary, you know, I could come to you with a membership unit contract and all this legal work, and I could say, hey, it's clear I own this, like I'll sell it to you for $100,000 or whatever. And in reality, unless that document were vetted and you contacted the GP, you could have bought a piece of paper that's absolutely worthless. The blockchain fixes that. Like you can look at the chain, you can see exactly where it's owned, and it streamlines a significant amount of the due diligence process.
what I've been told is think of blockchain as like an accounting system that is ledger-based. Would that be accurate?
Yeah, yeah. So like I like to describe it as a DLT, which is a distributed ledger technology. And we're like right now, everybody operates in these data centers that they're siloed. You know, the whole company, all the ledger of their data, and this isn't financial, this is data, ledgering just raw data. They're on, let's say, AWS or one server mainframe. And in these cases, what ends up happening is, or can happen, is you could have human error where the data gets corrupted, or outright fraud where, like, because it's one database that isn't being overseen by anybody else, it just opens up that level of a potential fraud or human mistake. So a distributed ledger is, let's say, 100 of these different types of servers. And so when you put information on one server, all of these other servers are confirming that information is true.
All right. So, and then now can we switch to tokenization?
Because
I hear a lot, you know, people are talking about doing this, and you know, even for 1031s and all kinds of things, you know, it brings this element of liquidity to, you know, investors and limited partners. And can you talk about how that might play into real estate?
I feel like I might have a different take on this than what I see a lot of other people do. So I would say liquidity is like the number one thing where people are like, hey, let's tokenize, it's going to make it liquid. It doesn't. There's like nothing about making it digital that makes it liquid. We're still operating, all the GPs are still operating in these isolated data environments where they won't share the LP information, and LPs don't have access to other information that's out there unless they go on the internet and look for like every 506C deal that's out there. And liquidity comes from these people, right? So when you look at the stock market and why the stock market is so liquid, it's because everybody can see the whole board. They can see every deal that's out there. They can go in and out as they want. Tokenizing sure makes it more liquid in the sense that it's easier to obtain or get into and to sell, but it doesn't bring money, right? It doesn't bring liquidity. We still have a problem of, and blockchain, in my opinion, does solve this. We still have a problem of GPs operating in these very siloed environments. Like, we need everybody to come to the table so everybody can see all the deals, and that will bring liquidity.
Walk me through, like, let's say I tie up a property with a broker, and I'm in escrow.
Yeah.
And I want to move forward with this. What are the steps? So what I would do is I would take that deal, I would do a whole bunch of due diligence, I would put it into a business plan, and then I would send it out to my accredited investors, the one I've been vetted already.
Okay.
And they would go thumbs up, thumbs down. Then there would be, I would send them into we use IMS, and then they would go into there, they would fill out the PPM or the private placement memorandum, and then wire the money. So that's our typical process. Mm-hmm. And then they go onto a Schedule A inside of our operating agreement, and you know, then the deal's done, it's funded, we close. So all that money, of course, is raised at the same time. We're putting our debt together, and then that all goes to the seller through the title company. You know the process.
You want me to tell you what it is right now, or you want to tell me future?
I want to tell you. So I know what I do now, and we've done that for 22 years. I'm wondering, what do you see? How do you see all that changing?
Okay, so right now, nothing changes. You still go through the same due diligence process. If everything is on blockchain, so let's frame this as now all the data is on blockchain. You confirming title, all the due diligence that you would in acquiring that property is instantaneous almost. Like it doesn't take days, it doesn't take hours. It can be confirmed right away. Going through the down the whole line from signing contracts, that's all done automated. It's all done through the interface. It's all signed on blockchain. But we have to get, you know, clarity from the legal system that's going to be okay. Like right now we're actually signing real contracts and just mirroring that on blockchain. Settlements of, like, you go to the LPs and the LPs, let's say they all agree that they want to do it. They come into the deal. Your settlement's like 15 seconds if they're all coming in through crypto. But I mean, previously we were just talking about not having to use crypto. If you don't use crypto, then, you know, it's a normal banking settlement process, which could be 2 to 3 days depending on like where you're coming from. But the future, when you start mixing in AI. So blockchain is really just creating this database of immutable information and data sets. So you know that it can't be changed. And if it was changed, you would see a trace record of that. And so you can rely on that information. The future with AI is what's going to be interesting, because now you're not necessarily, I think you being a good GP would go find these unsuspecting deals that aren't on the market necessarily, but all information that's on the market is going to be on blockchain, right? So now you're just going to KenGPT and you're saying, hey, find me a deal. And so it's scouring all the deals. It's taking your investment profile. It's taking your LP's investment profile, like the types of deals they like, the types of assets, hold times, whatever it is, student housing versus single family versus multifamily, whatever it is. They take all that into configuration. And then now the AI is saying, hey, this is the deal we recommend.
I want to touch on the fact that you built us a KenGPT. Because... like, that was kind of unexpected, and it was very cool. And I think that, you know, everyone kind of at this point knows what ChatGPT is. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think it's a cool idea for people's businesses to understand, you know, our KenGPT or whatever they can do for their business. So mm-hmm. Do you want to explain that?
Yeah. So ChatGPT is really just a language model on top of whatever data sets they're collecting from. So I think their data sets mostly go up to about 2021 or so, and that's where it's capturing its information from. But you know, when you look at it, a lot of information is incorrect, or like it doesn't understand the intent behind the user. You know, when you're asking, you know, who's Ken, it doesn't know which Ken you're talking about. But when, like, what I did for you guys this morning was just I just created my own data set. Like, you vectorize this data so the AI can read it, and so now I can control the data that the language model is reading from and creating that like human context from. And so really it was just me indexing your site, like anything I could find about you guys, and just putting it in there. And then now it's KenGPT.
You said it learned just like ChatGPT, but you know, if somebody asked like who's Ken, it would pull up Ken McElroy and his accomplishments and what he's done, and then they can find things on the site too that way, right?
Yeah, so it'll talk to you, like, the more I talk to it, it actually will change his answers a little bit. I can do two things. I can make it where it only gives, like, very specific answers, like when asked a very specific question. This would be good for FAQs, good for knowledge base, or I can implement the ChatGPT part, which is where it won't just verbatim give me the information I put in there. It'll humanize it a lot more, right? So it might not give me all the information. It might lead me to ask another question that then drills into to a different answer.
Before you came, we had some like Q&A here, and you said if you want to discuss a product, it would be Verity. What is that?
So Verity Block is our social media platform, and it's basically, I don't know, people say it's like Facebook and LinkedIn, but specifically only for the real estate industry. And Verity is the AI. So it's verityblock.ai. And so we have our global AI there, but what we are doing is we're going to create 100 individual AIs for people like you, Mauricio, Michael Flight, like just industry professionals that are top tier influencer, very well accredited individuals. So, and we're doing that completely for free. And so what that will do is it'll, one, empower you guys to have your own AI. But what it does for us is if you guys want to move forward and contribute your information to the global AI, now we're compiling the best minds of the real estate investment world into a single focused AI. So if you are a GP, if you're a lawyer, if you're a CPA, if you have any sort of credible and knowledgeable information that can help other GPs, help other vendors, help LPs, then definitely reach out. And we'll talk about making an AI.
And then what's the best way for them to get a hold of you?
Jared@dcap.finance. So dcap.finance is one way. You can reach out to me on LinkedIn. That's where I spend a lot of my time. And so my LinkedIn handle is @AssetTokenization.
Well, it was awesome having you on the show.
Yeah, thanks for coming in.